What is up, everybody? Welcome back to another video. In today's video, we are here with the first injury report of the week for the Lions and Vikings divisional matchup. Plus, we have some news from both sides, from Mike Zimmer, from Dan Campbell, some practice updates. We also have a new IR update, which is unfortunate for the Lions side. There's a lot to unpack here, so let's get it started.
Yep, we're going to bite a kneecap off, and we're going to stand up, and then it's going to take two more shots to knock us down. And on the way up, we're going to take your other kneecap, and we're going to get up, and then it's going to take three shots to get us down. And when we do, we're going to take another hunk out of you. Before long, we're going to be the last one standing.
Welcome everybody to another video. Glad you guys are here. And before we get this thing started, I do want to let you guys know, we've talked about doing the All 22 live stream, possibly videos, where we kind of break down this Lions versus Bears game. And I know it's Wednesday, and you're like, wait a minute, it's Vikings week. Why are we doing this? I'm sorry. The NFL just hasn't put out all the clips yet. We only have like 40%, so I don't know when they're going to do it. I'm hoping by tomorrow. So I know it's Vikings week, but we just got to adjust. We got to just do what they give us. So we'll just see what happens with that, and then we'll know for future weeks how we want to approach it. But right now, there's not enough clips where I feel like it's fair to dive into it, because then you're only seeing like one play, you miss four, and it's like, okay, I don't really know what happened. I think I want to start with the Vikings first, because there's a lot of names to get into, but they have some big news over there, good news and bad news. There's just a lot to talk about today. So let's start off with the Minnesota Vikings. Then we'll get over to the Lions. We'll get over to the IR updates, things like that. And we'll talk about some of the latest news from both sides. It was a relatively big trade that went down. It didn't have an impact on the Lions, but I thought I would at least bring it up. But let's start off with the Vikings first. As you guys can see, this is their injury report from today. In the bottom left is their IR. I'm pretty sure this is accurate. Okay, some of these, you know, I may be missing a couple of players here, but there's some weird ones like the Jalen Twymans, things like that, who I believe is out for the year. But either way, I'm pretty sure this is pretty accurate. It's injury reserve, but I do have my top two guys on there. You can see Harrison Hand, Cameron Dantzler. Both those guys are on COVID reserve, so it's not necessarily injury reserve, but they're still on something. So I just put them under that list. Cam Dantzler, who tested positive, but he did say he is vaccinated, so he should not be on there very long. Harrison Hand has also been placed on the COVID list. I don't know his stance on that or what's going on with him, but I also know that he is on this list. And both those guys are cornerbacks. And then the rest, you know, are just guys that have been on IR, like Nate Stanley, the quarterback, you know, Chad Beebe, Smith Jr. is probably the big one here, the tight end. So another guy step up who we'll talk about a little bit, but that's their IR. Now, the Vikings did activate a wide receiver off of IR, Dan Chizena? I don't know exactly how to say this dude's name. He hasn't played a lot offensively, but I just thought I would at least throw it in there. And also fans sarcastically are kind of like, oh snap, hey, now we're good to go. Like the Bears, we saw it. Now we're seeing a little bit with the Vikings fans as well. They're not super happy with the 1-3 record. So people are asking for Mike Zimmer to get fired. Not to where Matt Nagy was, but people are, you know, they're not happy with the record. And that's the thing, man. Just a couple of plays in the NFL can decide games. And I think that's why things change so quickly. Now let's dive into this injury report. Let's start off at the top with probably the big news. And I do want to point out, I did put 4-3 because they run a base 4-3 defense with Mike Zimmer. I just wanted to make that clear, because sometimes I do forget when we're talking about 3-4 so much, what defense they play. And I'm like, wait a minute, how do the positions work? Oh yeah, they play a 4-3 defense. So I just wanted to point that out just to remind everybody. But let's dive into this. Starting off the top, we have Anthony Barr. This is a big one. Anthony Barr has not played that much in the last two seasons. The guy played two games last year. He has not played this season. However, it looks like he may be making his debut against the Lions, as today he had full participation. Pretty sure he actually took a pay cut at one point, as he was listed with the worst contract for the Vikings. You know, he hasn't been maybe the stud, and he hasn't been consistent in terms of being on the field, but he is a good player for the Minnesota Vikings. He puts up a lot of numbers. The word we are getting from the Vikings is that he is expected to play this week with a knee injury. He was listed with full participation, so that'd be a big return. We kind of had something happen like that last week with Eddie Goldman, who made his season debut against us for the Bears. So I guess this is just a team to make your debut against, and yeah, that's what Anthony Barr looking like he is going to do. So that's a big addition for them. I know Twitter was very excited about it. If you roll through some of the comments, they're like, hey, we're going on a win streak. All right, we're going to the Super Bowl. Anthony Barr's back. I don't know if he's that impactful, but he is a good player. So it's a good addition for them. Continuing down, Chris Boyd, the cornerback with a hamstring injury, was listed as full participation. One thing you'll notice about this injury report is there is no limited participation. They have a couple guys with no participation and a lot of guys with full participation. They listed a lot of players on here. All right, but you have Chris Boyd, the cornerback. And this is important because, as we see from the COVID list, having Hand on there and Dantzler, I don't know exactly when they're going to come back. You know, some of the things are you vaccinated? Are you not vaccinated? The rules are kind of strange if they test positive. There's a whole bunch that goes into that. Then the cornerback depth is very helpful. Now, Chris Boyd hasn't really played much defensively this season. He's only taken eight snaps on the defensive side of the ball. He's been mainly a special teams guy, but you never know if they're missing some pieces. Also, Bashaw Breeland. Now, he has been a starting cornerback for them, and he has not played well. If you like numbers, his numbers aren't good. You won't like those numbers, okay? 22 for 26, all right? Allowing a super high completion percentage, a 154 pass rating, which is just crazy. He has not been very good in the red zone in particular, which Mike Zimmer pointed out that Dantzler was better there last week because Bashaud Breeland was sick last week, so Dantzler had to step in. He played a pretty solid game against Odell, against that Browns defense. We talked about Dantzler yesterday, but Bashaud Breeland was sick, so he didn't play last game. However, he has now been listed with full participation. It actually may be a good thing if he's healthy against. I'm just going to be honest because he just has not played that well, but he may be returning this week. It'll be interesting to see if Dantzler is good to go and he can play, where the snaps go. But honestly, I feel like they're going to go to Bashaud Breeland just because that seems to be what Mike Zimmer likes. I don't know. We'll continue. Cameron Bynum, the rookie. We know the rookie out of Cal. Okay, I remember this guy, man. He really made his presence felt, I feel like, at the Senior Bowl. But this cornerback dealing with a abdomen. Okay, abdomen. I see you with the big word. Full participation. Now, this guy has not played much defensively either. Only 5 snaps on the defense side of the ball. So these are your depth guys, special teams cornerbacks. But again, you just never know. If you're missing pieces, they may need more snaps. But he's a young player. Here's the big one. Delvin Cook. All right, we all know what Delvin Cook can bring to the table. And he's had some injuries in the past few years where he hasn't played in every single game, and specifically last week he only had 9 carries for 34 yards. It was not a huge game for him. In the first 2 weeks he went 20 plus carries, but last week he didn't get a ton. And Delvin Cook has been listed with an ankle injury, no participation for today. Now there has been some murmurs or rumors out there that more of a rest day today for Delvin Cook to make sure he is right. However, this is still a big name that we'll keep an eye on. But Delvin Cook did tell us that he feels like he's not going in the wrong direction. And he kind of told us that he's prepared to play even though he's not going to be 100%. So he said right now he's not 100%, but he's prepared to play through that injury. So it sounds like even though there's no participation, he's planning on playing this week. And that's kind of the word that we've been getting from the Minnesota side. So we'll see how that progresses. Behind him, they have guys like Alexander Mattison. They also have Fear Amir. Ooh, Amir Abdullah, baby. Those are some of their backup running backs. So we'll keep an eye on it. But it sounds like Cook has said on he's going to play this week. Probably looking for a big game this week against his Lions run D, which definitely struggled a little bit last week against the Chicago Bears. Continuing, Joseph, this is their starting place kicker who is 6-for-7 on the season. The only miss was the game winner against Arizona. Yeah, that was a big miss. But he didn't have any attempts last week because they only scored 7 points. Finds himself back on the injury report. He was on the injury report actually last week. I think he was listed as questionable, but they cleared him for the game. He only had to take 1 extra point and he made it. But he's back on this again. Either way, though, it's full participation, so I think he'll be okay. Another big one, Eric Kendricks. Okay, Eric Kendricks has played every single defensive snap so far this season for the Minnesota Vikings, but he is still full participation. This is that starting middle linebacker for this Vikings front seven. A lot of these guys, you know, you're familiar with a lot of them. I mean, just coming into the year, you kind of know what you're going to get from this Vikings defense. You know what players you're looking at. You know the defensive fronts usually be pretty solid aside from last year, and you kind of know what linebackers you're looking at. It's the same guys year in and year out. Now they have some new depth pieces. Detroit dies. You have your Sirotsis backup, so you have some young dudes, but the starters, like, we've seen these guys a lot. We've seen these players a lot, and we've had some struggles against the Vikings, but their run defense has not been very good so far this season. So either way, Kendricks, he looks like he's going to be okay. Another big one, though, Michael Pierce, the nose tackle, I guess you call him, even though it's a 4-3 defense, a lot of times lines up in a 1 tech. He's 340 pounds. He's a big dude, and he was a big addition at last year. Remember, he opted out because of the COVID stuff, but this season, I mean, he made his mark right away against the Bengals with a big sack in the inside. He's a pretty good athlete for being 340 pounds. He demands double teams. He's a lane clogger, so this is huge, especially because the run defense still hasn't been stellar. So when you have a guy like this, Michael Pierce, who is dealing with an injury, and it looks like he could be out for some time is the word that we're getting, with an elbow that came up against the Browns, and he didn't play in the second half at all. They had Armon Watts step in, and he played a lot of snaps. Talk that, okay, hey, they could just push a guy like Delvin Tomlinson into the inside to play Michael Pierce's spot, push Sheldon Richardson at the 3 tech, and then boom, you're good to go. But I guess Mike Zimmer said he wouldn't do that. So maybe we'll just keep seeing Armon Watts, who's been kind of up and down throughout his career, I guess you would say, at that spot. They also did add a defensive lineman, a 300-pound defensive lineman from the LA Chargers. This is TJ Smith, probably just for depth purposes. So yeah, I mean, it seems like they're being prepared for him not to play this week, and that's kind of what it sounds like is going to happen. So we'll see what they do, but playing that 4-3 defense, that's usually what it is. They have the top 2 defensive tackles. They had some studs there. Michael Pierce was a huge get back, but he looks like he may not play in this game. So we could be looking at some Armon Watts. We could get some Sheldon Richardson mixing in, and of course, you have a guy in Delvin Tomlinson who is really really good too. Another addition for them. And at defensive end, we know what they got. Danielle Hunter. You know, you have a guy named Everson Griffin, who so far this season, only three games, already has 9 pressures. He's been really good for them. So we may see a little bit more of him, is what Mike Zimmer said. Either way, though, that's a big one. Amir Smith-Marset, another rookie, speedster out of Iowa. Remember him coming out. Toe injury, did not participate. Now, Smith-Marset really hasn't played offensively for this team. He's only taken 4 snaps so far this season for their offense, but it is just some receiver depth I thought to point out. We know about their top couple of guys, but just some depth there possibly could be missing. Udo, oh my gosh, I know I messed it up this day. I know I am. I'm going to hear it. I'm going to be like, I said that wrong. It's like Ole Udo, but they shorten it because it's got a long, weird first name. I'm sorry. This is their starting right guard who kind of stopped the right guard carousel they had of different guys mixing in and out. This year they brought in Wyatt Davis from Ohio State. A neck injury, had full participation. So it seems like he's going to be good to go this week. This is a good start for him, but Wyatt Davis is the backup if he can't play for whatever reason. Nick Vigil, another starting linebacker who I believe has taken every snap defensively. He's taken every snap defensively for this team. He has already over 30 tackles so far this season. He has an interception, even though he's allowed 15 on 17 completions. But he's a player that did not participate. So there's a couple of pieces that could be missing, some big pieces to this defense. But like I said, they got some young guys. We'll see how that goes heading into this weekend. And finally, D.D. Westbrook. Yeah, remember him from free agency. D.D. Westbrook with a quad injury, full participation. Oh, he's played a little bit. He has 2 receptions for like 28 yards so far this season. Not a ton. He's gotten involved a little bit. I liked D.D. Westbrook this offseason, but he's a Minnesota Viking. So long injury report. I know there's a lot of names there, but there is some big news within it with Delvin Cook, Michael Pierce, of course, Anthony Barr looking to possibly make his debut. The cornerback position is kind of like, what's going on there? Who's going to get the snaps this week? So there's a lot of things to just keep an eye on. And of course, the COVID list, because of how weird and sporadic it seems to be, who knows? I mean, who's going to be available? Is Harrison Hand going to be available? Who knows? You know, is Cam Dantzler going to be available? Who played well last week? Point out Irv Smith Jr., the tight end, who has not really played. They have their backup in there, Tyler, who's already had 13 receptions. He's played well. He can play a lot of different spots, can play a lot of different positions. Very versatile. He's played well so far this season. So they've been okay without him out there. I just wanted to point that out. But now let's move on to the Lions side of the injury report, because there's some big news here as well for our Detroit Lions. Okay, now not a ton of names, but there are more players that have been added to IR. Yeah, IR is starting to fill up. Think about this. I mean, it's like the Lions last, since Jared Davis, I think it actually may go further than that. I mean, the Lions, most of their first round picks in recent memory are out right now, wherever they are. Jared Davis with the Jets, he's dealing with an injury. Taylor Decker, he's on IR. Frank Ragnow, newest addition, now on IR. So Frank Ragnow joins IR. He'll be out for at least 3 weeks. Weren't sure how serious it was. Version of turf toe. It didn't sound like he was going to play this week anyway. So it's not really breaking news there. It's just unfortunate he's going to be out for at least 3 weeks. And the Lions did prepare for that. Yesterday, they signed Ryan McCollum. Dan Campbell said that we like him. He plays center, so he'll be a backup center. And they do have Evan Brown, who will start at that role. And Campbell said, I don't think he missed a beat. There's a few plays I'm sure he wants back, but he didn't miss a beat when he was out there. So we have a good offensive line coach in Hank Fraley, who usually does a good job of having guys being able to step up, fill in, and we can be all right. And I do think Evan Brown looked good, but you know, Frank Ragnow, he can be a game changer. We know that. But last week, unfortunately, there was a game changing play in the wrong way, you know, for the Bears when we had the messed up snap. But either way, he's been added to IR, so that's just not good news. Since we've gotten the word that it's not likely that Taylor Decker returns this week, the Lions could be out a few offensive linemen. We know Evan Brown's starting at center. You know, we know Taylor Decker's probably not going to be back. So that means Matt Nelson will probably continue holding out right tackle. And, you know, he was solid, but he still had his missed reps too. We played against a vicious D-line, but it's not like the Vikings are going to let up, especially at defensive end. There you have some studs. Hunter is ridiculous at defensive end. Let's be real. Fast, explosive, pass first moves. Everson Griffin's been really good. They got depth there. They're tough at the defensive end spot. And like the Bears, they don't blitz a lot, but they don't have to. They get a ton of pressure. And what it did to Baker Mayfield, and we're talking about one of the best O-lines in football, it gave him a lot of issues. The Bears gave us a ton of issues last week. So again, that becomes the focus, is the Lions' pass protection and the offensive line. Run blocking first, but then pass pro. And Campbell said we're going to be smart with it. We're going to make sure that we protect some of those guys, you know, probably chip blocks, things like that, certain play designs they're going to run to try to, you know, take care of those offensive linemen that they're missing. But again, that becomes kind of the battle to watch of the game. And that could honestly decide the game, I think, once again. Because I think last week, that's what decided it. Bears defensive front versus our offensive front. They won that battle pretty decisively, and we lost the game. We had some mistakes come from that, and some big game-changing plays that came from that, even including the fourth down play, which could possibly be thrown into that mix as well. So, obviously, offensive line dealing with some injuries, it's not good. Next week, I don't know. Hope, please. Okay. Let's get into this injury report, though. First off, TJ Hockenson. Yeah, he's a new addition to this. Harris with a knee injury. Last week was not Hockenson's best week. He's just been put on this list. He's apparently was in good spirits, so it looks like he feels like he's in a good spot. And today's practice, according to how Dan Campbell said it, sounded like it was more of a shorter practice tied in with more teaching. Instead of just being straight up practice, it was shorter practice, more teaching, and that's kind of what it sounded like today as they were going to roll through their installs and game plan. So just like the Vikings may have limited Cook a little bit more of a rest day, even though they listed with no participation, that could be what's going on here with a guy like Hockenson. We'll teach him stuff, but we don't need him on the field. And I think that's fair at this point. So tomorrow will be a big day. Tomorrow will definitely be a big day for Hockenson. But to add something with the practice is that the Lions did say that, yeah, their focus is on third downs. And Campbell said usually Thursday we go to those situationals, third downs. But he said we're doing it every day now. Every day after a drill, if we have to, we'll do a couple of third down plays and, you know, make sure that we're efficient. And of course, your defense gives them work too, because they're going to see a lot of third downs now in practice, and they've been really good at it. So this is a good defense to honestly go against, because Aaron Glenn has dialed up pressures, dialed up blitzes in third downs. This should, in crazy way, make our offense better at third downs. So I like the focus there, and it has to be there, because third downs, as much as it sounds like, oh, it's just third down, but that also, to me, impacts red zone situations, because they kind of all do tie in together, where you have one play to get 4, 5, 6 yards. You know, it's kind of the same situation. Hope they do some red zone work on a shrunk field. That way you don't have all this area and you have to find a way to design plays to punch it in a shortened field, because things get a lot tougher when that happens, okay? Y'all play Madden. It does. Continuing down, Penei Sewell, another big one here. He was dealing with a little bit of an injury last week. We saw him kind of kneeling down, kind of grabbing his ankle a little bit. Sewell did finish that game, so you like the fact that he played through it. Definitely was not a good game from Penei Sewell at that tackle position, but Campbell said he's banged up. He is in question for this week. They're not sure. They're just going to have to see how the week goes. They really don't know if he's going to play or not this weekend. Obviously, we want Penei Sewell out there, especially when you have another backup tackle and Matt Nelson, and then you have your backup center. The more starters you can have out there, the better, that's for sure. So we'll see how the week goes with Penei Sewell. The good thing is he did finish last week. We'll just have to see how the week progresses, but I can give him credit. He did show a lot of heart, I think, playing through it and finishing that game. He just didn't play extremely well, but I will give him credit for that, for a young guy to play through it. That was impressive. However, what will the Lions do if he's not there? Well, they have a couple of options. Will Holden, of course, who's played some snaps with us, could definitely just take over that left tackle spot. And you'd have Holden and Nelson and Evan Brown going against a very vicious front seven that's got a ton of pressure. Now, I think the run game, we could still have an advantage there, honestly. But, you know, pressure-wise, yeah, they've been a problem at getting pressure. So, you know, we'll see how that goes. Another option is possibly taking a guy like Big V, who Hank Fraley called a true professional. He'll play any spot we need him to. Pushing him to left tackle, which is more of a spot that he's probably more comfortable with than right tackle, because this was his Super Bowl run position. He played left tackle through their Super Bowl run when they beat the Patriots. So they could do that, slide him to left tackle, push a guy like Logan Stemberg, who's played well when he's had to, at that guard spot. He's taking a few snaps as well, push him at right guard. So there's options, but we just hope we see Sewell. Continuing, Michael Brockers, still in this list. Defensive end, limited participation, shoulder injury. Okay, nothing new there. Unfortunately, it's actually sad to not see Romeo Okwara on this list. I miss seeing my man Romeo's name. Yeah, Romeo Okwara, we know, is on IR now. And it used to be like, hey, Brockers, Romeo, they're always on this. And then we still got Swift. Yeah, that's cool, but I kind of miss seeing Romeo. It's the little things in life, you know? It's the little things. And not seeing Romeo is actually sad, because we know now, as you guys see in the bottom left, he is on IR and he is out for the season. It is a huge, huge loss. But I do want to talk about what the Lions did. So we talked about, you know, the outside linebacker that they brought in a couple of days ago, maybe a week ago at this point, defensive end / outside linebacker they brought in from UTSA. We dove into that if you want to check out some film. But they also today, or I should say in the last 24 hours, promoted Jesse Lemagne, okay, an outside linebacker off their practice squad, who's about 240 pounds, to the roster. Now, they had this spot open because Frank Ragnow went to IR, so they had the spot open. So it could mean a few things. They're not completely sure if Trey Flowers is going to play this week. That could be part of it. Also be part if you just had the roster spot open, so why not do it? And they can still leave competition out that, hey, Austin Bryant, Julian, you're not locks to get the snaps just because this guy is not here. We do have Charles Harris. Hopefully we get Trey Flowers. But Jesse Lemagne, I'm going to be honest, man, he was good in the preseason. When we brought him in and we talked about it to our additions of practice squad months ago now, geez, this dude was good in the preseason, okay? So Jesse Lemagne, he's a speedster. He's got a lot of speed around the edge, probably more of a pass rushing specialist. Meanwhile, the other addition that we made, whose name is slipping my brain right now, to UTSA, to me could be more of a run stopper, even though he had, you know, more talk about being a pass rusher coming out. Either way, it's just depth that the Lions need, but he's a little bit smaller in comparison to the other guys, about 275, he's 240 pounds, but he can definitely get after quarterback. I would say that's his strong suit for sure. And that moves you on to Trey Flowers, defensive end slash outside linebacker, knee injury, but he was limited today. So for the first time in now 2 weeks, all right, he has practiced. Last 2 weeks he didn't practice, last 2 weeks he didn't play, but he has practiced today, and they're hoping that he comes back this weekend. He was wearing a big knee brace on his right leg, all right, and also it was taped up, but he did practice, okay? And the same, remember Justin Fields, he was wearing a brace on his hand? Well, he played against us and he seemed fine. Trey Flowers is practicing again. He was, you know, getting taped up with a brace. So I hope he plays. We need Trey Flowers. We're missing a lot of pieces, and we need Flowers to be really good. I don't want just Flowers. I need Trey to be $90 million Flowers. I need Trey Flowers to be that guy for us. So we'll see if he is. I just hope he plays this weekend. That brings us on to DeAndre Swift and Jamal Williams. Both running backs are on this list. Swift's been on here for the last 2 weeks, so there's nothing crazy with this one. Groin injury, limited. We'll see how that goes. I don't think he was doing anything last week. They didn't talk about it, but it was definitely not his best game. I say pass pro definitely could use some work, and I'm pretty sure he's probably focusing on that, knowing Swift. We'll just see who the guy is that's the hot hand. Last week, it was that guy, Jamal Williams, and he's on here, limited. New addition, he's on here with a hip. The talk that I've heard about Jamal Williams, it sounds like it's not necessarily something that they're scared is going to keep him out. It's just, hey, you know, he was the guy getting some hits, taking some bangs, some bumps, some bruises. 14 carries, 4.7 yards a pop last week. So this may be more, hey, we don't need to give you full participation. It's early in the week, so why do that with some of these vets that you know what you are going to get? So of course, we still do have my guy, Jamar Jefferson, if we ever need him. I'm just saying, you know, you definitely could. I think Jamar would be good for us. But anyways, we'll see what happens with that position. Hopefully those guys are healthy. So I would say there's arguably possibly some good news here. But there's also some bad news, you know, with the Hockenson new addition, with the Romeo, you know, obviously we knew that one. Frank Ragnow is not just a weekly thing. Now it's at least 3 weeks. So that's not good news. But as we know, I mean, hey, every team deals with injuries. And the way I look at it is like, okay, and this is no hate to them, but Penny didn't play that well last week. Like the Hawks, you know, for your expectations, for Sewell's. So you still got to go out there and play, regardless of who's out there. Every team's dealing with injuries. Yeah, we're dealing with a lot of our top picks. Just cannot shoot ourselves in the foot, and we can give ourselves a chance, I think, against anybody. And Dan Campbell said it again today, we are really close. He feels like they're a really, really close team. And right now, you know, the guys that he's looking to are, you know, a lot of the captains, but he brought up guys like Dean Marlowe, Khalif Raymond, Jared Goff, Michael Brockers, Alex Anzalone, Jason Kabinda. Those players to kind of pull everybody along, because he wants those guys ultimately to take over the team. And both these teams seem like they could be better than what their record shows at this point. I mean, the Vikings obviously missing a field goal to beat the Cardinals, who are out 4-0. That tells a lot. Last week against the Browns, hung tough with them. They missed a couple of opportunities there. And of course, our team has missed opportunities pretty much every week so far this season. I feel like the last couple of years, we've talked about avoiding the injury bug to have success, but at the same time, it just keeps happening. Yes, we get injuries just like other teams do. Maybe we do have more than others at key spots, but I like the perspective of this is just opportunities. You know, like Hank Fraley said, for some of these UDFAs, this is their chance to push themselves onto the scene, and this is how you get these opportunities. Unfortunately, that's how you get them. This is how you make a name for yourself. I want to talk about some around the league stuff, because of course our cornerback position, and Dan Campbell said this week with Jerry Jacobs, he said it today, I think he deserves a shot. And what happened last time Dan Campbell said that with Derek Barnes? The guy played a lot, and he basically started. So this sounds like, it does, that Jerry Jacobs may get the start this week at cornerback, because the Lions haven't made any other moves to go bring in another cornerback. However, he did still say that he thinks Bobby Price can help them. He added that to the end. So maybe he's still looking to find a way to give Price snaps. He wants, you know, them to be involved, but maybe take some snaps away from them until they're ready. Maybe they're just not ready yet. So that's kind of what it sounds like Campbell saying here. But it also sounds like Jerry Jacobs is going to get the nod to start at cornerback, as he said he deserves a shot, which I'm very excited for if he does, because I'm excited to see Jacobs. I think Jacobs can play, and I think he can make some plays. I think he'll get beat, but I think he can make some plays as well. So I'm excited to see that. But there's been some moves around the league recently. Today, Stephon Gilmore, the cornerback from the Patriots, was traded to Carolina for a 2023 sixth-round pick. And I see that. I'm like, whoa, what? Like, why didn't we make that trade? Reasons that it went down, first off, they were actually going to release him. There were some contract talks. He wanted to get paid. He wanted to adjust this contract, get this top-paid deal. And the Patriots didn't want to give it to him. They're like, hey, man, we got to see you on the field. Last season was not his best season. It was still very solid. It just wasn't 2019 when he was, you know, the defensive player of the year. It was a solid year, but it wasn't the same year. And this season, he hasn't played yet because of that quarterback. quad injury at the end of 2019, at the end of 2020, which is carried over. However, the words that we've been getting is that he's healthy. He's good to go. However, they just haven't played him yet. Getting a trade with the Panthers. The word is right now he's still playing on the same contract, which is about $5.5 million cap hit. So with the Patriots, what was going on there is he wouldn't get paid. So there could be a point in time where the Panthers end up paying him, and that's why they made that trade. That way there's no craziness going on there as well. So I just wanted to point that out. It's not just as simple as the sixth round pick, but he has been moved to the Panthers. And then you look at a team like the Packers, who have just picked up Jaylen Smith, the linebacker. And Smith has had his issues in Dallas, but that was one that a lot of, you know, fans were talking about when he got released from Dallas. Well, he has been picked up by the Green Bay Packers. He's a fast linebacker, that's for sure. He can fly around. I know people love him on Madden because he's like the best user guy. But he has had some, you know, issues instinctually picking the right hole, things like that. I just want to point that out because the Lions have not made any changes to their cornerback position. They have added the center. They brought the new outside linebacker up, but the cornerback has stayed the same. So it sounds like right now Jacob's going to get the nod this week. You know who I was hoping for, but I'm just saying it probably ain't going to happen. Anyways, let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thank you, Brian, for watching, and I'm out.